Hello and welcome to the first video in this multimedia design course for print. Gareth here from tastytudes.com. So to begin, I'm going to kick this off and talk about preparation for print design. Now, when preparing for print, you will want to make sure that all the assets you have that you want to include in your design are adequate. We will also want to prepare our project folder so everything is ready for an efficient and organized workflow. Now, there are a lot of things we need to keep in mind and be sure are correct before we dive into the design process. In this video, I'm going to be touching on the following topics: image quality, image file types, color references, project preparation, and document specification. Now, if these things are not addressed early on in the project, they could come back and haunt you later. Just when you think you have finished your design and it's ready for print, you get the printer calling you up and saying that various elements of your design are not right. Images are not high quality enough, or colors are wrong. If this happens, then you will need to go back over your work and spend more time tweaking it. A bit of a nightmare. This has happened to me a few times. Now, some printers are more flexible than others, but if you're doing a job, let's be sure it's all correct. So in this video, I want to share with you my experience and inform you of the things I prepare for and look for before starting design for print. While I discuss these topics, I'll also be referring to the documents that we will be producing later on in this course, so everything is in context for you. So the first topic I want to discuss is image quality. So ultimately, any image you use in your composition for print is going to be seen on the printed page. We will need to ensure that once printed, images look clear and legible and maintain the highest standard. To qualify images for our print design, we need to keep in mind three things: image size, or as I like to call it, the physical size, image resolution, and aesthetic quality. Now, the image size needs to be sufficient enough to fit comfortably on the canvas area without blowing up the image above its threshold. This would result in image distortion or pixelation. Resolution needs to be high enough to ensure quality and legibility. To ensure the best quality, the resolution should be at least 300 dpi. DPI stands for dots per inch, and this defines the density of pixels contained in an image. Now, aesthetic quality is how it looks. Is the lighting good? Is it clear? Is the sharpness good? If the image size and resolution is sufficient, yet the image is all blurry and unclear, then it would not be good to use. So let's take a look at an example. So here we are in Adobe InDesign, and this is the brochure we will be creating later on in this course. If you wish to take a closer look and follow along with this, you can download the project folder. Link is in the description. So this is a brochure, and the document size for this is A5. Which is 148mm by 210mm, so not a particularly large format here. Now, as we scroll down, we can see that we have various images included in the composition. So I'm going to click on one, right click and edit with Photoshop. Upon click, this will open the image, which we can edit in Photoshop. So in the layers panel, we can see a series of image effects that have been applied. But we are not going to focus on this right now. What we are going to focus on here is the image quality. In fact, I'll toggle off the visual effects so we can see the original image. So I'll come up to image, scroll down and hit image size. So I'll come down and change the value on the right to millimeters. So looking at the image size, we can see the width is around 200 millimeters and the height around 134 millimeters. Now, our document is only 148 by 210. So this image is more than large enough to work in our document. We can also see that the resolution is set to 300. Perfect. So this image qualifies for both image size and resolution. We know this will be sufficient enough for the printed brochure. But what about the aesthetic quality? Well, if I close the image size window down and take a look, if I zoom in here at 100%, we can see that all the details of the image are nice and sharp and clear. So a good image to use. So to use any image for our print design, we must ensure that all three criteria are ticked: image size, resolution, and aesthetic quality. So what about image file types? Well, when working in print, in particular with InDesign, we can pretty much import any type of image into our document, such as JPEGs, TIFFs, PDFs, EPSs, Illustrator files, and PSDs. Though we might want to stay away from GIFs and PNGs, as they are generally used for digital graphics, which have been highly compressed and may lack the quality required for print. As long as your images are of adequate size and pass the quality criteria, they should be fine. So the next topic I want to talk about is color. Now, color usually comes down to cost, quantity, and the nature of your design. When it comes to designing for print, depending on how you plan on printing your document, you will need to use the appropriate colors. For example, if you're printing a business card with a simple design that only consists of a few colors, chances are it will be more cost-effective to use only Pantone colors. You will also find your end result will be more bold and vibrant, as you will not be layering colors on top of each other like you would using CMYK. If you do use Pantones, then your printer will require you to determine the correct Pantone colors in your documents for them to reference. Now, if you're printing a business card, and perhaps on one side of the card you want to include a photo, then you would need to use CMYK, because then you would be using a wide spectrum of colors. So let's take a look at an example. So first, let's take a look at a business card. For this design, we can see it's fairly simple, including only four colors. So on this occasion, it would be wise to only use Pantone colors. So if we look over in the swatch panel, we can see we have the four Pantone colors that make up this design. Now these colors were taken from the branding document, which clearly specifies the CMYK and Pantone colors. When we export and send to print, the printer should be able to identify the Pantones to use. Now, if we take a look at the brochure, we can see that this is a more complex document. There is a lot more going on here, which also features images. So the only way we are going to print this is to use CMYK. So if I come to an image, right-click and edit in Photoshop. Once open in Photoshop, if I come up to Image, click on Color Mode, we can see that this is currently set to CMYK. When we prepare images for our print document, we must always ensure that the images are set to CMYK. We will be learning more about this when we come to create images for the brochure later in the course. It's important to mention that because we are using CMYK for images, we should also use CMYK colors in the document. If we look over in the swatch panel, we can see the swatches, and if I double click, we can see the CMYK color values. These references, like with the business card, were taken from the branding document. Now, if the images are not set to CMYK, and we make the mistake of using RGB colors in the document, then you may get a call back from the printer asking you to change them and resubmit your document for print, and you do not want that. So when applying color for print, we must use the correct colors for the right print setup, either CMYK or Pantone, and make sure any images are set to CMYK. So the next topic I want to talk about is project preparation. Now, before I start any design project for print, I always prepare a project folder. Print documents can contain anything from a single image to hundreds of images, so I find it important to organize my files so everything is ready for an effective and organized workflow. So in my project folder, I usually have these five main folders: research, design, work docs, assets, and PDF exports. In the research folder is, of course, any research or mood boards I have created in the research process. In the design folder, I'll keep all the design process, such as drawings, mock-ups, or color swatches. In the work documents folder, I will keep my documents that are prepared for print, such as my InDesign files. In my assets folder, I'll keep all the assets that either I have prepared myself or have been supplied to link into my print documents. In the assets folder, I have categorized my assets even further, as not to mix them all up. Here I keep my PSDs, JPEGs, AI, Illustrator files, PDFs and TIFFs separately. Should I use any other file type, I'll simply create another folder for that. Lastly, I have the PDF export folder. So this is where the finished documents will be placed ready for print.
These will be the documents exported from the print documents. So preparing an organized project folder like this will prevent any wasted time looking for any assets or files in future. Now, you don't necessarily have to set up your folder like this. This is an example of a system that works really well for me. The idea here is to be organized.
So the last topic I want to talk about is document specification. Now, as we create for print, we will be making sure that all the design elements are perfectly laid out and everything looks right. But you must also keep in mind that the document is set up correctly to be passed on to the printer for them to print it correctly for you in future. When it comes to document setup, we must keep in mind marks and bleeds and correct document size. So what are marks and bleeds? Well, marks and bleeds are there to aid the printer to align various pages together when setting up the document to print, such as crop marks and fold marks. Bleed allows for a margin of error around the cut area of your artwork when a printer trims your document. In the instance where you have full bleed imagery in your document, if the trim is not perfect, you may get a white line around the outside of your page. Let's take a look at an example.
So in InDesign, we can see one of the spreads for the brochure document. Now we can clearly see the cut area around the outside of the canvas area. Now currently, we are looking at this document in preview mode. If I now press W, we will enter into normal mode. And here we can see all the guides that help us create the composition. Now if we look around the outside, we can see a red line. And if I zoom in here, we can see that the base grey colour, which is full bleed in the document, crosses the cut area and ends on the red line, the bleed. If I press W repeatedly, we can see the cut line and the bleed line. So when setting up the document, if we use full bleed, we must ensure there is adequate bleed. Now this is usually specified by the printer. It's usually between 3 and 5 millimeters. So here we are now looking at the PDF which was exported from the brochure document. Here we can see all the necessary marks and guides which the printer will use to correctly line up the pages, fold and trim the pages, and collaborate colours. We will be learning how to set all this up later in the course. Lastly, we should really know the exact size of the document from the very start. If you spend a long time designing your document to a bespoke size and find out later you set up the wrong size, this could cost you a lot of time in future to put right.
So those are the things you need to keep in mind as you prepare and develop design for print. Now, when I design for anything, before I jump onto the computer, I usually start on paper, sketching my ideas out and thinking about how I might want to lay out my design. These drawings are referred to in the industry as scamps. Now these are great to keep things fast, creative, and it's great to communicate and share ideas with others before spending lots of time building the design on computer. In the next video, I'm going to discuss scamps, what they are, and how important they are to the design process. See you in the next video.